我們這個2020年僱傭修訂條例生效日期公告的小組委員會呢，現在我們的法定人數是夠的了，那我們開始了。
This is the Subcommittee for the Employment Ordinance Amendment 2020 Commencement Notice. We invite the officials to join us. We have Assistant Commissioner for Labor, Mr. Raymond Liang. Also, Mr. Raymond Ho, Assistant Commissioner for Labor. Ms. Rebecca Chen, Senior Labor Officer. And Government Counsel, Ms. Annette Lai. Welcome. Now, if the administration are ready, they can brief us on the document that they supplied. The document is very simple. It's about the commencement date. We believe we may have some questions. We invite the administration to brief us on CB bracket 2196. Stroke 2021-01. If members have questions, we can raise them. And this is mainly extending the maternal leave for 4 weeks, the commencement date thereof. And we will discuss the policy areas. Good morning. I will briefly introduce the document. Now, the Employment Amendment Ordinance 2020 was passed in third reading in LegCo on 9th of July. Now, according to 1(2), the Commissioner of Labor will implement the bill from the date of Gazette, and on 9th of October, this commencement notice was gazetted, and it specifies that the 11th of December will be the commencement date, and that in the first meeting of this session of LegCo, this notice was tabled to LegCo for scrutiny, and the Department of Labor has started the publicity and education work so that the public understands the clauses, the contents of this amendment ordinance. And also, the Labor Department has set up reimbursement of maternal leave pay scheme, and we hope that the scheme can be implemented in the first half of next year, ASAP. Now, Mr. Lu Junhong, Dr. Fernando Cheung have raised their hands. Any other members wish to raise questions? If not, well, there will be me also. 4 minutes each first, including answers. Mr. Lu Junhong. Now, the Employment Amendment Ordinance 2020 was passed. The is something that the labor sector has and the social welfare sector have tried to achieve, and the limit have the upper cap has been raised to $80,000. Now, earlier the government wants to increase an establishment position now so that the Labor Department can help the employers to be reimbursed, and the application was confirmed. Actually, the failure to for the new position to be implemented will not have any adverse impact? Now, the government hoped to have a new senior labor officer for this purpose. And even though there's going to be outsourcing of the reimbursement work, we hope that this position can be implemented, and so we hope that this can be considered by LegCo. And in the meantime, the Labor Department is doing the preparatory work on the reimbursement scheme. I myself and other colleagues are involved on the preparatory work. We are doing all we can. Now, as Mr. Liang, also Assistant Commissioner, said, our target is still that in the first half of next year, we could implement the scheme in the first half of next year ASAP with applications from employers. Now, on new positions in the establishment, now we all know that the government finances are tight under the pandemic. So the government wishes for money to be spent where it's essential. Now, it's not that we have a firm position on the new position. Now, since you are outsourcing the reimbursement scheme, which actually I'm not quite in support of, but it's been done. It's been planned. Now, so does this warrant the new position of a senior civil servant, or can you redeploy your staff so that the scheme can still be implemented? Now, since it's going to commence on 11th of December, now why don't you just go ahead and see if you can manage without the new position? Now, on the 14-day weeks of maternity leave, we hope that this is one step further in the progress. We hope that the government will review the period of maternity leave so that there can be more family-friendly policies. Dr. Fernando Cheung, I have several questions, one by one. Now, first, on the extension of maternity leave by 4 weeks to be effective on 11th of December. Now, previously the government wanted the commencement to be 18 months, rather, after the ordinance was enacted. So this is a great improvement. Now, the Secretary was very firm in requesting 18 months. Now, in January, on the 12th of January this year, on his blog, he said that this will be a new mechanism, new staff, and a new technology system, and the technology system has to be subject to tender testing, training, and formulation of the framework, and so on. 18 months it would be very tight, but once the bill was passed, 6 months, in fact, was enough. Now, the Secretary should not speak lightly. Now, he repeatedly said it's very tight, it must be 18 months, and then it becomes 6 months. So what happened? Was the secretary exaggerating, or was there some reduction in the actual work to be done? I actually wanted to ask the same question. Now, many members have this doubt. Why is there such a big leap forward? Now, the commencement date can now be 11th of December this year. What happened? Was there a previous a wrong estimation, or are there new ways that the government has come up with? Thank you, Madam Chair. We thank Dr. Cheung for his question. Now, the member said that originally we asked for 18 months. Now, that mainly means that the Labor Department would directly implement the reimbursement scheme. That involves the Labor Department and the government setting up or creating a large computer system, and there will be manpower arrangements, training, finding a new venue for the office. So the 18 months refers to the case where the Labor Department directly implements the scheme. So there's a lot of preparation. It will be a large computer system. It will take about 18 months. So according to the original thoughts, it would take till the end of next year before we can implement the reimbursement scheme. Now, right now, in the previous panel of manpower discussions, the government understood members' concerns for the reimbursement to be effective as soon as possible. So we adopted the outsourcing mode. Now there will be assistance from the contractor, so the preparatory work can be shortened to about 6 months. So originally, the target was the end of next year. So on the reimbursement scheme, we hope that it can now be implemented as soon as possible in the first half of next year. And the effective date of the amendment ordinance now, there will be 14 weeks of maternity leave. So the female employee can have the leave, and the employer has to wait till the end of the 14 weeks, and when all the money has been paid over to the employee, and then he will apply to the government, and that will take about 3 months. So if the amendment ordinance becomes effective on the 11th of December, then by the earliest, by next March at the earliest, the employer can apply to the government for reimbursement. So we hope that this target date can be accommodated, that the reimbursement scheme can be effective in the first half of next year, so that the employers can apply. So it's two different modes. Originally, it's the direct preparation by the Labor Department, and now we work through outsourcing so to shorten the period to 6 months. Now, your time is up, so I will follow up. Well, actually, you took 1 minute. Okay, I will let you have 1 minute. Now, I have 2 points that come to mind. Now, the secretary obviously kept giving us the worst possible picture, so that he exerts a pressure on us. Now, this is not the proper way to do things. The timetable is not that tight. He tries to create some sort of animosity, as if the LegCo is standing in the way of others.
I don't know why the secretary said something like that. Secondly, don't you have to review this? Why is it that if this were done internally by government, it would be so much slower than outsourcing it? Is it that you have such poor efficiency? If that is your logic, why don't you outsource the entire government? If the efficiency of the government is so low, why don't you outsource the work of all the 180,000 civil servants and go back to the era of C.H. Tong? Of course, this is not a simple task, but there is no reason why you are doing it this way. You are telling the public that you are working so slow. I think you should do a serious review and explain to the public the problems of your internal operation. Outsourcing is not the solution. Very often, when you outsource the work, you also outsource the responsibility, and you are detracting from your accountability. Well, I think your original estimate is way too removed from reality. Next, I'd like to talk about timing. The administration is saying that you outsource the work and the scheme will be developed and the FC has given you the money. The question is, it is estimated that the scheme can come into operation only in the first half of next year. The thing is, the amendment ordinance will be implemented on the 11th of December if we support you. So are you telling us that starting from the 1st of or 11th of December, if a child is born and the mother is entitled to salaried maternity leave, then the first 10 weeks, of course, will be the responsibility of the employer, and you are only going to reimburse the other 4 weeks extension? In other words, if a woman gives birth on the 11th of December, she will be entitled to the extra 4 weeks maternity leave and the employer will be entitled to reimbursement. Is that right? But then the scheme will not be up and running by then. Even if employers don't come to you in January, February, he will come to you in March because he will have to give the pay to the female employees. Are you asking employers to wait 3 months so that you have time to set up the scheme before they can apply for reimbursement? Yes, Chairman. We have to strike a balance between two intended objectives. One, we would like the amendment ordinance to come into effect as soon as possible in order to benefit female employees. This is one of the important objectives. The secretary has appointed the day of 11th of December, which is the earliest possible date. And I'm asking you, by March, the employers will have to also pay maternity leave, extra pay to the female employees. Well, yes. So on the one hand, we want the amendment ordinance to come into effect as soon as possible in order to benefit female employees. Well, we don't quibble with that. We are asking you. The ordinance will come into effect, but the scheme is not up and running. How can you reimburse the employers in due course? Do you have any contingency plan for the Labor Department, for example, to pay upfront? Or is it that you will have to ask employers just to wait until the scheme is ready? What is your intention? Right. That is why I was saying that the commencement date is one of the objectives. But on the other hand, the preparation and implementation of the reimbursement scheme will be worked at, and we want to complete it as soon as possible. And our target is to do it within the first half of next year, so we can try as much as possible to tie in with applications from employers. You have not answered my question. My question is, a woman gives birth on the 11th of December, and then starting from the 11th week, the employer would be paying on your behalf, and then he might want to apply for reimbursement from you, and then you will tell him, okay, we have got your application, but the scheme is not ready, and we still have to develop the system. Is that going to be the case? Or is it that you will somehow reimburse employers first? Because after all, the employers will approach the Labor Department. They will be submitting applications to you. Do they have to wait an extra 3 months before they will get reimbursement? Chairman. First, under the Employment Ordinance, employers have the responsibility to first pay the employees, pay for all 14 weeks of maternity leave. As for the application for reimbursement from government for the extra 4 weeks, as we were saying, we are trying our very best to try to tie in the scheme with the commencement notice. But we are just doing the tendering work. Just last Friday, we completed the acceptance of bids process. And still, the target is to implement the scheme within the first half of next year so that we can tie in with employers' applications. But as to when the scheme, on which day the scheme can be rolled out, well, we still have to complete the entire tendering exercise, and then we'll have to work out the scheme with the processing agent so that we can fix the date for the commencement of the scheme. Okay, so you still don't know when you can reimburse employers. Even if they come to you in March, they will not get the money until your system is ready. Is that the case? Thank you, Chair. The government has already made the pledge. Yes, I know you have made your promise, but then you are not going to be reimbursing employers right away. So are you telling them to wait, that as long as they wait, they will be reimbursed when the system is ready? Is that the case? As we were explaining, we are trying our very best to roll out the scheme. But as to the exact date of implementation, we have first to confirm which processing agent we are going to have, and then we will have to work out the scheme with them so that we can roll it out as soon as possible. I don't know why you are dodging the question. Why don't you just say yes or no? Members and the public viewing this meeting will understand that it is a no, and it's just that you didn't want to say it. Any more questions? Mr. Kwok Wai Kong. And then Dr. Fernando Jung, second round. Thank you, Chair. Good morning. A few things today. We are only talking about the commencement notice because the amendment ordinance was scrutinized at the LegCo plenary. Chairman, I must beg your pardon, but I like to mention why we have advanced the implementation date by 1 year, that it only takes half a year instead of 18 months. I think that has been discussed in full in the LegCo meeting. I think there should be more communication, and members must remember what has been discussed so that we can save time at these meetings. Now, we are saving 1 year's time for implementation. Usually, the administration is slow, but then they have worked fast this time. And so I don't think there should be more arguments. What I'm concerned about is we have been able to do it faster because we are outsourcing it. We have been able to save on tendering time, and if it were done by the government, you would have to set up a computer system and recruit people. And in order to do it fast, you have chosen outsourcing. But from the angle of trade unions, we would like you to have people on your establishment doing it. This time around, you have saved time. I'm not going to ask you to redo it, but after the outsourcing scheme has been up and running for some time, when it is going to be smooth and you know how much manpower you have, and if you have time to set up a computer system, I'd like to ask you whether it is possible to revert the work to civil servants in the future. I don't think I'm going to get the answer today, but I'd like you to take this back to your bureau to think about it. Because in the long term, it is not satisfactory always to outsource work. You should always try to reduce the volume of outsourced work. Of course, we want to benefit female employees as soon as possible, and that is why we allow you to do it this way, this time. Another point. After the system is set up, the first batch will be reimbursed after half a year, but I don't know about future batches. Now, the economy is not in a good shape, and if you will have very tight purse strings half a year later, how can they get back the reimbursement, Mr. Ho? About the last question from Mr. Kwok. After the reimbursement scheme is up and running, when the employer has paid full maternity leave pay to his employee, then he can submit his application. He doesn't have to wait. But first, he has to pay the employee in full first, and then he will submit the information to us for reimbursement. If he meets the conditions, he can submit the application. Well, yes, he can submit the application, but if he hasn't received the reimbursement, then he should not be able to wind up, because if he doesn't own an account anymore, he will not get the reimbursement. Mr. Ho.
Yes, Chair.
I think, Mr. Kwok, you are asking a question about a very special circumstance. First, the employer will submit the application after meeting all the conditions. And of course, the government will have to process the application. And we will do it as fast as possible so we can reimburse him. But as to whether there are special circumstances, well, the major premise is if the employer is entitled, I'm sure the administration will use all means in order to reimburse the employer concerned. One more point, Chair. Yes, the ordinance stipulates that the employer must pay up in full first, even if he is in economic difficulties. And of course, he wants to be reimbursed. You say this may be a very special case, but it is a possible scenario, and I want you to really think about it. Just now, Mr. Kwok's question has not been answered. You are outsourcing the scheme. When the system is developed, actually ask the same question at the FC. Does the system belong to the administration? Will it be that after a few years, the system would be handed back to the government so the Labor Department can operate it? About the computer system and the intellectual property right, our understanding is that it belongs to the government. As to the question you asked, we have heard your question, and I think we need to allow the reimbursement scheme to run for some time before we will review it to see the future arrangement for this scheme.
Dr. Fernando Chung, thank you, Madam Chair. Now, we of course hope that the system can be up and running as soon as possible. The government just said that the employer has the obligation under labor legislation to pay 4/5 of the pay of the employee, that is the maternity leave pay, to pay it over to the employee. So she took the leave, and then within 72 hours, her maternity leave pay, that is 4/5 of her regular wage, would be paid over to her, and then the employer would apply to the government for reimbursement, and depending on the effective date of the system, as you said, it would be March next year, then the system can begin to reimburse the 4 weeks maternity leave pay. Now, this is my understanding. Now, there is concern about the contract employees. Now, for contract employees, if one's maternity leave lies outside the end of her contract, then she doesn't get the 4 weeks additional benefit. Now, I don't know what the government thinks about this. Now, if she is the employee, she should still enjoy the 4 weeks of additional pay, but if not, she doesn't get it. Now, for the employees, this becomes a big hurdle. Now, if the contract ends and the employer doesn't renew the contract, then the 4 weeks of maternity leave pay should be enjoyed by employees normally, but she wouldn't get it. Now, how do you resolve that? We thank the member for his question. Now, Dr. Cheng talked about the time issue. Now, under Employment Ordinance, when is the maternity leave pay going to be paid? It would be at the usual time for payment of salary, and it cannot be more than 7 days after that. Now, looking at the employment contract provisions when handling the amendment bill, we realize that this is a complex issue. So the consideration would not be at this particular juncture of looking at the maternity leave pay, additional maternity leave pay. Now, if the one contract is renewed by another, then she would still be under continuous employment, and she would enjoy maternity leave and the maternity leave pay. Now, the official refer to contract staff situation. Now, if the contract is renewed, then she can get the additional 4 weeks pay. But if the contract comes to an end, she doesn't get the 4 weeks pay. So that creates an incentive for the employer. Now, if the employee maternity leave just falls outside the contract period, then he would stop the employment. Now, he would rather hire a new staff member. Now, for many grassroots workers, they rely on their wages. Now, so if he can find a way to avoid that 4 weeks pay, he will do it. So this would be an incentive for female grassroots workers to be fired more easily. The government, I believe, understands that. Now, even though you're saying this is not an easily dealt with matter, now you should think in terms of protection for labor, whether from the legislative or from the legal or market point of view. You want to protect the workers' interests. This system creates an incentive. In fact, it would damage the employees' interests. Now, in other countries, they have studied this matter. So you should study the matter, otherwise the employees might be fired during her maternity, during her pregnancy period. Now, if the employer fires the employee because of her pregnancy, that would be infringement of sex discrimination ordinance. Now, actually, the employer doesn't renew the contract, then he doesn't have the legal responsibility. Perhaps the DOJ can supplement. Does the existing legislation protect these grassroots female workers? Let me try to respond briefly to Dr. Cheung's question. Now, he said that the legislative amendment might create or increase the incentive for employers to end the contract after it expires. So the pregnant employee doesn't get the protection under the amendment ordinance. Now, on the amendment, whether it affects the employer's behavior. Now, we will have to look at the cases after the ordinance comes into effect to see whether there are increases in this phenomenon. So we increase the pay by 4 weeks, the government will reimburse it for the employer. Will there be greater incentive to fire the take unfavorable action against the employee? We have to see about that. Now, in some cases, the contracts might be renewed every time, but it so happens that the employee gives birth and then the contract is not renewed. Would that constitute sex discrimination? Would that be an infringement of that ordinance? That depends on the actual circumstances of the case. Now, we have seen some cases where some employees made complaints at the Equal Opportunities Commission, and I believe the EOC will deal with such cases of suspected discrimination. Dr. Chow, so the government is willing to take a look at it, that's fine, but I hope it's not just a look. I hope that they will have a plan to conduct a review, and that review should include this issue. Now, for many grassroots female employees, you expect them to complain at the EOC or enter into lawsuits. Now, they have difficulty just making a living. So they have little time or ability to further complicate the matter. So the government, to the employer, may in fact be tempted to do that. So the government should provide more publicity and education so that those concerned know that this cannot be done. Now I don't know whether the Labor Department has received complaints or seeking help from employees about being fired because of pregnancy. Now, if there's an infringement of the employment ordinance, as Madam Chair said, that is, if the employee is dismissed during pregnancy or before the maternity leave is over, then that would be a direct infringement of the employment ordinance, and our staff will deal with that. Now, the number is not large. It's likely to be a few tens a year. Well, a few tens a year is still a large number. Now, in some cases, the issue was resolved by mediation, but if there is evidence that the employer dismissed the worker unreasonably, we might prosecute. And some employees might go to the labor relations section of the Labor Department, and they would try to lodge a complaint. Now, that is not under the employment ordinance, but under sex discrimination ordinance. So we, in that case, we would suggest that the employee go to the EOC to register the complaint and to gain more understanding of her rights. Now, I come back to the document. Now, here we are dealing with time issues. Now, in paragraph 7, the government said that the Labor Department in the second quarter of this week already set up the preparatory office for reimbursement of maternity leave pay to coordinate and commence the preparatory work for the scheme. Now I believe you have received tenders already, bids already. Now, in the second quarter, you set up the office, and now it's the fourth quarter. Only now are you going ahead with the tender. Why is the progress so slow? Why does it take up to the now fourth quarter before you have before you receive the bids? Is it a shortage of manpower that it takes two quarters? Now, concerning the tendering, well, first we have to, well, this is a entirely new scheme. So the government is using public funds to reimburse what the employer paid under the employment ordinance for the maternity leave pay. So we have to have reference to other similar government subvention schemes where, about their designs. And also, we have to draw up the tendering document. Now, that's quite complex. So we have to ensure what the agent is supposed to do, how do we monitor its work, and so on. So that takes time to formulate the tender document. Now, as I said, last Friday was the cutoff date for the submission of bids, and we had to give the interested parties to draw up the tender, the bid documents. Now, our office has to think of drawing up how to draw up the guidelines and the requirements.
We hope that when the processing agent is ready, we will have the other systems in place to tie in with early implementation. Can you let us know what is the establishment for the preparatory office? And also, when you have decided on the processing agent, would you hand over the preparatory office to the agent to operate? Or is it that they have their own operation and then at the office, you have civil servants doing their work? Thank you for the question. As you pointed out, the applications from employers will be received under the scheme and the applications will be processed. That will be done by the processing agent on our behalf. But then at the same time, we do not outsource our responsibility. We still have a role to play to make sure that the reimbursement scheme is operated according to our standards and also our service pledge and also the rules. So we have the role of contract management. What is the establishment of the preparatory office? When we sought funding, we had applied for creating 30 posts and that was approved. I believe over 20 persons have taken up the posts. Well, now you are outsourcing the scheme. The actual operation would be done by the processing agent, right? Why do you still need 30 people in order to manage the contract? I think you need just 3 people. Can you explain to me how come 30 people have to sit there all the time in order to watch over the processing agent? Can you explain to us why the duplication? Thank you. We have the processing agent to help us process the reimbursement applications, but then the office has other work to do, as I said, for example, contract management. And also, the office is responsible for the actual reimbursement. This cannot be trusted to the processing agent. And also, we will random check the work of the processing agent. We will random check a certain percentage of the work of the agent to see whether it is processing applications according to the rules. And there must be supervision of the scheme, including policy implementation. That would be done by the Labor Department. Are the 30 people working full-time just to watch over the implementation of the outsourcing contract, or do they have to take up other tasks within the Labor Department? The present plan is that these 30 posts are responsible for managing the scheme. I think we'll need the administration to give us a paper to detail the exact work of these 30 persons and how they relate to the processing agent to see whether there is any duplication of work and how responsibilities are divided. This is to facilitate debate at the LegCo meeting, and we'd like to see whether there is any duplication. We want to see a clear delineation of work and responsibilities. And later on, if there will be any disputes about reimbursement, should they go to the processing agent or should they go to your office? I think we have to make it very clear to the public and members. We want to know exactly the division of labor between the agent and your office. Your paper doesn't comment on this point. Yes, Chair. As members mentioned, on the 3rd of July, at the Finance Committee meeting, when we discussed the creation of a post of principal labor officer, similar concerns were voiced. And in response to members' questions, after the 3rd of July, we already gave a written reply to the Finance Committee to provide information on the manpower for the preparatory office and its scope of work. We have already supplied the information to the FC. Have you amended anything? That is, after you have submitted the paper to the FC, have you revised the scheme? No, we haven't done any revision to the paper. Maybe the clerk can retrieve that paper for us and circulate it to members again, so we can revisit the establishment to see whether it is a reasonable arrangement. Dr. Fernando Zheng. Thank you, Chair. Yes, this is something we need to pursue. We have about 50,000 babies being born every year, and it's not that every mother works. The labor participation rate may be about 70%, but we are talking about some of them working in the government, so they will not be part of the reimbursement scheme, and others may work in large corporations, which are already providing 14 weeks maternity leave or even more. I don't know about the unit cost. There will be 30 people from the Labor Department, and I don't know how many people will work in the agent. And they are just tackling thousands of cases, maybe like 20 to 30,000 cases every year. So how much are you spending on the management of each application? What is the unit cost like? I'm very interested in finding out that information. If you have already got the answer, have you done your sums? Have you got the answer? The administration, you have already got the bits. How many people are being proposed by expectant agents to be working? Thank you, Chair. It's only last Friday that we cut off the acceptance of bids. So we have just got the bids and we are reviewing them. But we must emphasize that this is a competitive bidding process. We will be giving scores in order to identify the agent and evaluate the bids. But it is going to be competitive. Well, I don't think they have the answer, that means. I hope you understand what I mean by unit cost. That is, how many applications there will be each year and what is the overall cost for processing the applications. You do a simple division and you will know the unit cost and let me know it later. Also, after the ordinance comes into operation, what will be the effect on the work of the government? Civil servants now have 14 weeks ML, and would that be impacted upon after the ordinance comes into effect? Well, civil servants are paid in full instead of at 4/5 of the salary. Will that continue? And also, there are contract non-civil servant posts. Will these people be affected? And also, there is another type. This is also quite often done within government, and that is you go for employment agencies which are engaged to do government work. A lot of departments are doing that. I don't know whether the Labor Department is doing it. I know the LCSD, the Post Office. The Post Office is outsourcing the work of collecting mail from on-street mailboxes to do the work. And these are not postmen because the work has been outsourced. Now, about the reimbursement scheme and the reimbursement of maternity leave pay, are you impacted in any way within government? Okay, can you comment on your different types of employees? Thank you, Chair. As long as I understand, civil servants are already entitled to 14 weeks ML with full pay. As for non-civil servant contract posts, I think they are in the same category. As for agents working on behalf of government, executing government work, since the employees are not directly employed by government, but by the agent company, the employment ordinance provisions will have to be implemented as a result of agreement between the agent company and the employees. These people will be different from civil servants or non-civil servant contract posts. Okay, and you mean there will be no standard for these agents who accept outsourcing work from government? You don't have a standard for the employees' benefits. Well, if work of the government is outsourced to agent companies, then departments concerned may have different modes of contracting out and requirements. And it will be up to the departments concerned to manage that work. Okay, about civil servants, is it that it has been implemented throughout the service? I think that started in October 2018. Do they get full pay or forfeits? Full pay. I hope you will implement full pay for ML as soon as possible for everybody. As you know, people outside government are only getting forfeits of full pay. Dr. Fernando Jiang asked about unit cost. If you read the paper from government, it says that every year, about 27,000 female workers will benefit from ML. And if you have 30 people in the preparatory office and also the people in the agent, I think the unit cost is going to be very expensive. Any more questions? If not, let us look at the commencement notice. There is only one line. Administration, would you like to walk us through it? Employment Amendment Ordinance 2020, commencement notice. It reads like this. Under Section 12, 1 bracket 2 of the Employment Amendment Ordinance 2020, bracket 13 of 2020, I appoint the 11th of December 2020 as the day on which the ordinance comes into operation. Okay, this is only about the commencement date, that is the 11th of December 2020. Any questions? If not, legal advisor. Thank you, Chair. I'd like to inform members that we have checked the Chinese and English versions of the commencement notice and we have found no discrepancies. Thank you. If members have no questions on the policy aspect and also the actual wording of the commencement notice, I will now talk about the legislative timetable. At the last meeting on the 2nd of November, members agreed that the scrutiny period should be extended to the legislative meeting on the 2nd of December.
Now, on 11th of November in Council, I will move a motion to extend the scrutiny period. According to usual practice, the subcommittee before that deadline will submit a written report to the House Committee. So please take note of the following timetable. The deadline for scrutiny period 2nd of December 2020, the limit time limit for serving notice of amendment will be the 25th of November this year, and our date for reporting to subcommittee to House Committee would be 20th of November. Anything comment from legal advisor? Will the administration please give us the information on the unit cost as soon as possible? No. The secretary will also let the members know about the previous document on the establishment. Any further matters? Mr. Ho, I beg your pardon. Now, on the unit cost, now I believe at this stage, we will not be able to calculate that because we have to complete the tendering process before we can confirm the cost. That will be after we confirm the agent. Now, so during the scrutiny period, we believe we won't be able to supply that figure. Now, the tendering has ended. How many bids have you received? Four. How much time will you need to go through the four bids and come to a decision? Now, we hope that by the end of this year, we can confirm the contractor to be engaged. Now, this is the second week of November. It will take you one and a half months more before you can choose the agent. Can you speed that up? Because the ordinance is already effective now, so and you still now you started the work in second quarter. Now you are taking your time. The babies are being born, and you will take the end. To the end of the year, and then you have to take time for development. And can you speed that up? As I said earlier during the discussion, we try to speed up as soon as possible to implement the reimbursement scheme, but there are established needs in scrutinizing the bids. Now, looking at the government regulations concern, the requirements for scrutinizing the bids, now we hope that by the end of this year, we can confirm. So the 20 staff members in your preparatory office will be looking at the bids, or do you need others as well? Or would the bids be scrutinized at the secretary's level? Now, some of the staff in the preparatory office will be engaged in scrutinizing the bill, but after the assessment, we have to prepare a report. Now, according to the government procurement mechanism, there would be an approval process to be completed. Now, I just want to air my dissatisfaction about the poor efficiency of the administration. Maybe the efficiency office should take a look. We have completed the scrutiny in one meeting. We are very efficient. We will not drag our feet. Please do your part. On behalf of this committee, on 20th of November, I will report to the House Committee serving notice of amendment. That would be by 25th of November. If there are no further issues, I announce the end of the meeting. Thank you.